God can replace the pain in your past with peace in the present. He did this for a young man in impossible circumstances. Author Helen Heavirland is about to share this incredible story. You won't want to miss it. Stay tuned. This is Time Out, and I'm Carolyn Sutton. My co-host Patty Sandifer joins me welcoming you to the program today. Welcome, Patty.
Welcome to you, Carolyn, and welcome to you. Today we have back Helen Heavirland. She is here all the way from College Place, Washington.
It's a ways.
Yes, yes. I get the College Place and the College Dale sometimes messed up with the different schools, so that's a long way. We're really happy to have you back again.
Thank you. It's great to be back.
Thanks for coming back. So the last time that you were here, we talked about your second book, Zion, Champion for God. Mm-hmm. And in that interview, you shared with us that you like to encourage others to meet God's potential for them. And that did happen in the life of Joy Matthews, didn't it?
Yes, it did. She was a young woman who just felt like a plain Jane nobody with no gifts and no talents and couldn't imagine that God could ever use her. Mm-hmm. And yet God helped, you know, as she gave herself to God, God helped her to see what her gifts were, mm-hmm. and turn her love for animals into a real ministry that has brought joy to just so many people, as well as to her herself.
And she is well named. Yes. Joy. I had the serendipitous opportunity to literally bump into her in a bookstore at a women's retreat.
Oh boy.
Earlier this year. And she said, "We have a common friend, Helen Heavirland." And we talked, and she is bubbling, and I can just
the
see
joy is good.
Yes, I can just see why you chose to write her story.
Now, God brought dreams to her, that yes. things that she would never have been able to dream up. You know, God's yes. plans are just so wonderful.
Yes, He is good. Now, is that book, Zion, Champion for God, still available?
It is still available. And you can get it actually a couple of different ways. One of the ways is by telephone, and that phone number is area code 509-529-0723. Or you can go on the internet to the site called signedbytheauthor.com.
Oh.
All lowercase letters, all one word, but signedbytheauthor.com.
Huh, very nice.
That's great. You know, I know you have described yourself as I'm gonna see if I can say this, common as an old shoe kind of person who is amazed at what God can do. And I know in the conversations with you, you are amazed at what God has done in your life and through your life. You have written three books. The first one was about Jay Christian and his involvement in the occult and how God rescued him out of that, and now his ministry through Three Angels Broadcasting Network, especially on radio. And then the Zion book, and most recently, My Enemy, My Brother, a gripping true story of a man who survived the greatest tragedy of the 20th century. All of these books are absolute page turners.
Yes.
Now we were reading this for worship at home because, I mean, this God's miracle working power is just on every single page. And I'm just wondering, because I know writing a book takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of research, a lot of emotional output, it takes a lot of time. Why did you choose to invest so much of your life in this particular story?
Well, the easy answer is a publisher called me and asked me to check out this story and see if there was a book in it.
Oh my.
But when I went to check it out, it was just so fascinating to me. Here I was, knowing just a bit about his story, knowing that he had been a German soldier during World War II, had survived 3 years on the Russian front, some of the very worst fighting that there was, and so I, you know, I knew bits and pieces of his story before I went. And here I was with a man who had had probably as many reasons to be the victim of circumstances of anyone I'd ever known. And here sat before me this very gentle, soft-spoken man, just a very sweet person who joy came from him, just a man at peace with himself, and a man who had had a fulfilling and wonderful life. And I think that was the first thing that just really intrigued me about his story, is he could have been moped around as a victim of circumstances. He had plenty of excuse to do that, but he didn't. In the midst of horrible tragedy.
Yes.
And even from, it's interesting to me, as he grew up in Germany, he was a young man who experienced prejudice from the very beginning, who had difficult life right from the beginning. But as he grew and seemed like nothing would turn out for him. And then it was interesting, he actually at one point won a gold medal and won a university scholarship, and it seemed like finally things were going to turn around and life was going to be good. Life was going to be, he was going to have that dream come true. He had dreamed of being a dentist, but because of circumstances he knew he never could be. But this gold medal and the university scholarship, all of a sudden, things had turned around, his dreams were going to come true. But just then, he just turned 18, and World War II exploded. And here he was, in Germany, and before long, he knew the letter would come from the government, his draft notice, and it did. And before long, he was headed to the Russian front. And one of the things that I think of as he got onto the battlefield, and you know, suddenly as they marched toward the battlefield, the sounds of the weapons, it was no longer just target practice, you know, and suddenly the reality of war began to settle in. And then after the first battle, as he saw the Russian corpses laying scattered on the battlefield, and he spoke of what a horrible feeling it was, just the loss of life, and yet it was the enemy to him, and yet this horrible feeling of the loss of life, and yet he didn't know how he should feel about this. But then just a few days later, the person, or one of the people, who was a corpse lying on the battlefield was one of his friends.
Oh boy.
And if you don't mind, there's a couple places I'm going to be referring to your book. One reason this is such a gripping book to me is I was a history minor in college, and I was fascinated, of course, by how events seemed to evolve, especially during the two world wars. And I was fascinated by the fact that the German push into Russia was in some ways kind of the start of their downfall, because when Hitler overextended, didn't count on the bad weather, didn't count evidently that much on the vastness of Russia at that time. And so anyway, that really pulled me into this. But you have, God has gifted you with artistry and words, and as I got to the end of chapters, you know, just my husband would say, oh, is that the end of a chapter? No, worship's been kind of short tonight. Let's go for another one. But there's one place here, several places, that just jumped out at me. When he talks about, when you talk about, and we're talking about George Grellman, right?
Yes.
They had lost their first comrade from his military unit. And you talk briefly about, you know, the pain of burying this first, the first loss, and you wrote, and as from his perspective on the battlefield, we held our position till nightfall, and then I and others in my group, under the cover of darkness, dug a shallow grave. We laid our fallen comrade in it, said the Lord's Prayer, and buried our friend. The questions, however, were harder to bury. Mm. And you talk about the questions now that started coming up in his mind. And one of the questions was, who is the real enemy? And something else you mentioned earlier in the book was a Jehovah Witness, father of a family. Tell us a little bit about that and how that impressed George.
While George was in his basic training, he visited some people on the weekends, some family friends in a nearby city. And one Friday when he arrived, the people were very sad. And finally it came out as to why. And a neighbor of theirs, a family man, father of several children, had received his draft notice. And he went and told the officers, I will be glad to serve my country in any way possible. I will do anything except I cannot carry a gun. I will do anything to serve my country otherwise. And he was just immediately taken out and shot.
And he knew that would probably happen.
He knew that was what was going to happen.
But he still took the stand.
At the time when George heard this, and he saw this young widow and her several children, you know, near his friend's home, why would a man do that? As the war progressed, and as he realized what happened in war, that things weren't as clear and simple. Mm-hmm. It wasn't as clear and simple as we are protecting our families, our mothers, our wives, our girlfriends from intruders. When he began to see it wasn't that simple, and he saw the wider picture, he began to admire that man who would stand up for principle. Even though he knew it would cost him his life.
And and another question that George started asking himself was, what is life all about? That's amazing.
Yes.
That's amazing. And you also mentioned that when he had an opportunity, well, they had lots of opportunities to see the corpses of their, quote, enemies, and he realized that the young Russian soldiers were just like himself, young men trying to do the right thing by their country.
Yeah.
So what got him through?
What got him through? That's a wonderful question. It wasn't himself. He was a talented young man. He was a careful young man. But it was interesting, as the war progressed, his comrades began making comments like, I want to be near George. Nothing ever happens to him. Even officers chose to keep him nearby. One officer, for instance, said, you're no longer going to be a messenger. You're going to stay here in my camp because there's a special protection around you. He came to realize in time that truly there was. And time after time, when he should have died, he didn't. Times like the time a grenade landed 15 feet in front of him, skidded across the ground, landed at his boots, and did not explode. The time he walked across a bridge, when he got there, his comrades, he was a messenger at that time, when he got there, his comrades said, how did you come? And he said, across the bridge. And they said, you couldn't have. Yes, I did. But we'd already mined it. And again, George was not killed. Time after time, when there was no earthly reason why he should have lived, another thing that he realized, besides just knowing that it had to be God, the encouragement he got in his mother's letters.
Yes.
And she quoted scripture, and when, you know, he would go for months between letters, but he would keep his mother's letters and his girlfriend's letters. And and the encouragement, the scriptural encouragement. Psalm 91, Psalm 46, these were a couple of his favorites.
God is our refuge
yes.
and strength.
Yes.
And a very present.
Help in trouble.
And those scriptures would be in his mind. Mm-hmm. And he recognized that it had to be God. And he began, even though he had not been true to everything he had learned as a Christian, in a Christian home, he began to realize that God had not forsaken him. Mm-hmm. And that his mother's prayers were there with him.
And that was one of the questions he couldn't bury out here. Does God still answer prayers? It's interesting that you noted that his officers wanted him by when they themselves had almost wanted to get him into trouble because he would not drink with them, he would not smoke, he would not chase women, and things that the others did for recreation and just escape from the horrors of war, he was true mm-hmm. to his conscience and to how he'd been raised and got the ire of even his buddies up.
Mm-hmm. Almost always. Now, remember there was
an incident. That one time.
There was an incident where he chose to go along with them and to drink. Mm-hmm. And on the way home, he began to realize what he'd done. He stumbled just a little bit mm-hmm. and realized he had not stumbled on something. It was because of the drinking. Mm-hmm. And he began to think, would I want my mother to see me like this? Would I want my fiance mm-hmm. to see me like this? And he determined, I will never do this again. Oh. I will be true to my God.
Oh, wow. That's great. And I like the memory, you know, of the scripture and the letters and that type of thing, because I think we need to do that too. You know, I know many times in my life that is what's gotten me through certain circumstances, because the Holy Spirit brings it back to your memory.
In texts that he had learned as a child, that he'd memorized in his home mm-hmm. as a child even. You know, these became very, very real to him on the battlefield. Yeah. Mm.
And he was also put, was he not, in the last cattle car to be relocated from the front. And I mean, he didn't know it was the last. They were
right.
They were taking now the German soldiers out for retreat. And
yes, some who had come up, you know, for the retreat. They had a train that went out. He was on the last car. No train came after. They did not realize that. And there had been comrades standing on, you know, waiting to get on that train on the platform mm-hmm. who could not, you know, there was not room. They could not make it on that train. There was another one ready to go. They were getting onto that train, but the order came because of the change in the battle. His train had just left when the order came, no more would go. There were people there whose special friend was coming on the next train. Mm-hmm. That next train never came.
And the ones that were left behind were pretty much
wiped out. There were times, that one time where of his unit of 90, there were only 5 survivors.
That's just amazing. That's amazing.
Actually, I think there were 9 survivors at one point. They finally gave them the night to go into a Russian village to rest. The officer insisted that George go with him to his, where they found a cellar, not go with the other group. Well, in the morning, the other group, they received a direct hit. And mm-hmm. at that point, there were 5 survivors. And again, George was one of them, mm-hmm. which presents George with some interesting things to have to deal with, because how do you deal with the fact that you're home, your buddies aren't? Mm-hmm. One time when on a home leave, George went to church, the church he grew up mm-hmm. in, and he's enjoying the stained glass windows, the organ music, seeing the smiles of the faces of people mm-hmm. that he'd loved, you know, he'd grown mm-hmm. up with. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, the wife of one of his friends walked through the door carrying their baby. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And their eyes locked, George's and Rudy's wife's eyes locked. And she burst into tears. And George realized Rudy must have been killed. And as it turned out, yes, Rudy had been killed. So had Herbert. So had, you know, and he started naming the ones that he had grown up with and in that church. And basically, he was the only one who had survived. How do you deal with this? How do you deal with surviving when so many of your comrades were just left on a battlefield someplace?
I would be definitely evaluating my life and what I would be doing with it from now on.
That's right. Our time is going so fast. We don't have to. I want to whet our viewers' appetites. There were a couple allusions to, real, in addition to the fighting of the war, the unseen spiritual warfare. There were some occult issues came about. Happened. But he eventually ended up, I'll better move ahead here, as a POW right before the end of the war.
Yes.
In American hands?
Ended up in American hands, then ended up in England, and was held then for several years, even after he probably should have been let go. And during that time, received word that his fiance was going to marry someone else.
Loss after another.
There was just
his family in dire straits. His parents.
His story is so fascinating. He went back to see his parents in East Germany at one point on a short leave. Had to sneak across the border, had to sneak back. I mean, it's just, again, God protected him. There was no other way because a dog, you know, the dog they had to sniff out people.
Yes.
He would stop and look that way and bark, and then he would close his mouth. And they would go on. And there was no reason George should not have been found other than God simply muzzled the dog and helped them to not find him. I mean, just time after time, God involved himself in George Grohmann's life in a very, very crucial way.
And as a prisoner of war is when he came under conviction. Then he needed to start keeping the Sabbath holy. And just like God had spared his life so many times, he wanted to give himself fully to biblical truth. And ended up where? Far away.
Ended up on his way. George, who had had an eighth grade education, was a German-speaking person who had learned just a little bit of English while he was a prisoner of war in England, ended up on a ship headed towards South Africa, to a college in South Africa to become a missionary. And had been, here he is on his way with an eighth grade education to enter college in a language that he doesn't know well. And on the way there, as he has a number of times, he has had that wrestling with God. Are you really big enough to forgive me? Yes. And it was on the stern of the ship at that point that again he struggled with God. And, you know, he'd been a part of the killing. Was the fact that he had been a part of Hitler's army, was he partly responsible for this whole thing? And he just dealt with everything that had ever happened that he could think of. And finally, just at the end, just cried out, God, please forgive me. And he said it was like he could hear God's voice say, George, I have forgiven you. I have thrown every sin into the depths of the sea. And there was George. It was in the middle of a dark, stormy night in the ocean. And he said, I just could picture God picking up this whole bundle of all my sins that I had ever committed.
That's a good picture.
Putting it in his hand, pulling his hand back, and heaving those sins into the depths of the sea. And he said, I couldn't see into the depths of the sea, but in every way I looked, left, right, ahead, behind, I couldn't see the lights from land. I could only see the sea. And to know that my sin was buried. And in God's, he realized at that point, this is what grace is. Mm-hmm. And that was when he experienced peace at a level, and grace at a level that freed him to move ahead and be what God had, to fulfill the future that God had lined out for him.
And he ended up, God brought him another beautiful woman. I love the pictures of this book. Extremely, exceptionally handsome man and beautiful wife that God sent. And they ended up as missionaries, and partly in Rwanda, where I spent a number of years. I've been on that mission, so this book was extra exciting. During one of the times, and I won't give the ending away, but during one of the times of extreme loss in George's life and pain, he wrote these words. They resonated with me. As difficult and painful and lonely as those days were, my heart was strangely strengthened by God. And I think it is a strange and wonderful act of God when he can bring us a realization of grace in our lives, no matter what we've done or, you know, where we've been.
Yes.
Yes.
So that's what he would say to some of you today.
You know, I think what he would say to a viewer today is, there's some words right near the end of the epilogue.
We have people, all of us suffer, you know, different things at different times.
So yes, yes.
Need that encouragement.
Oh, all of us.
Yeah.
George said these words toward the end of the epilogue, I have tried my God. I know his promise is true. He came to give life that is abundant. Life with him, life serving him and my fellow humans, has filled my life with purpose, peace, and joy.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
God is big enough he can give peace no matter what has happened, whatever pain the viewer has. God is big enough.
Yes, he is.
He has peace bigger than that pain.
Amen. Oh, thank you so much, Helen, for being with us. We're looking forward to one more program with you.
Yes, we are.
And encourage our viewers to avail themselves of your books. Thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
Viewers, we always appreciate your being with us, and we just hope that you're back with us again next time. Between now and then, however, take some time out to let God replace your painful past with a peaceful present, as well as the hope of a fulfilling future.